But I think that my biggest thing is being a father. So I'm a father to Luca. This is my son, he's 5 years old. And when I travel to Nepal, I usually, when I travel somewhere, I tell him all the stories. So to know about the country where I'm visiting, what I will be doing there. And when I return back, I usually tell him stories about my experiences there, what have I eaten, people that I met. And among other things that I arrange when I come back, I will go to his kindergarten and I will tell the story about Nepal to the kids in the kindergarten. So I'm planning also to take along some interesting things from Nepal, like I'm not sure how is that instrument called that we discussed yesterday. So they will know the culture because I really believe that traveling is one of the best things that we can do in life. So, by the way, after this workshop, if you have a recommendation for what to get to him, you can ping me or you can tweet it to me and so on. But let's start with a few rules. I have few rules when I do workshops like this. So first of all, this is a stress-free environment. I don't want you to be stressed. If you don't know something, it's okay to raise your hand and ask. Also, I will have a couple of parts in this workshop where it will be open for any question, if you're afraid to ask that. It is in some points of the presentation, based on what I believe it's something that I discussed in this previous part of the presentation, so at this point you can ask your question freely. And just to remind, I can talk for 2 hours without any problems, so if you need a break, just let me know, okay? So this is to just know where is the question pause and where will I show you something from my past projects. But first of all, what is design? Right? I don't know the right definition, so I Google it, and this is the Wikipedia definition, which says design is the creation of a plan or convention for the construction of an object, system, or measurable human interaction. And it's like a bit dull, if you ask me. But here are some of the design principles, like graphic design, visual design, web design, user experience design, interaction design, and so on. So can everyone that fits some of this description raise your hand just so I can see how many designs are in the audience? Yeah. Not much, yeah? I see a few hands. So for the rest of you, this is not a talk and a workshop only about design. Don't be afraid, there are a lot of things that you can learn nevertheless. But based on all this, design principles, you can see that design changes over time. So interaction design wasn't something that we had 50 years ago, but this changed. And in a way, design changes over time, it adapts. So another question for those designers in the audience. So are you emotional about your designs, always trying to do better and trying to improve? Because if you are, I think you are a designer. And if you are passionate about what you do, smile while you sketch, always developing new ideas, then yes, you are a designer. Actually, I really believe that designers need to be emotional, they need to care about others, they need to be passionate about what they do, because if you can't be like that, then it's better to change your job. And when I say this, I don't think about design only, I think about everything you do. If you're a developer, if you're a front-end developer, if you're, I don't know, mowing lawns, it doesn't matter. If you don't have passion, if you are having a stomach pain, in the morning, when you wake up and you know that you need to go to work, then I think you have a serious problem. So, before we continue, I want to show you one video. I really feel about this video, so here it is.
And on the ninth day, God looked down on this blank canvas of life and said, we need a way to be reminded of the finer things. So God made a designer. God said, I need somebody to get up before dawn and obsess over fonts and work all day over details, look at art, culture, and design inspirations from different industries, scarf down some leftover Chinese food, and then work well past midnight after having delivered a seminar at the nearby college entitled, Why There's Nothing Funny About Using Comic Sans for Your Next Project. So God made a designer. God said, I need somebody with big ideas, big enough to overcome a committee, strong enough to defy the status quo, yet clever enough to get the CEO to lighten up, laugh a little, and remember that it's the customer who needs to be understood. And only then will the customer understand the company. somebody who impressed clients, tamed social media fanatics, and plowed through endless revisions, and still come back the next morning looking for more, so God made a desire. God said, I need somebody that can turn a blank page into a compelling message that makes viewers stop in their tracks, innovate a new brand that consumers just have to have, or design a building that makes the inhabitants glad to be there. Someone who, during crunch time, will finish a 40-hour week by Thursday and still put in another 25 hours living only on energy drinks. So God made a designer. Somebody who realizes it's people who make life worth living, and it's artists that raise the bar even higher, advancing the culture forward. And when culture does take a step forward, is rewarded when someone utters those few cherished words that make it all worthwhile. You made life better by being here. So God made a designer.
Video talks about design. I think it can be projected in many other ways, as I said before. If you don't have this passion for anything you do, then you're doing a really lousy job in the end. So I want to tell you my story. My first webpage happened in 1997. It was designed in Netscape Navigator Wall. When I look now, back at that time, I feel really ashamed, but Netscape Navigator Wall is a visual editor. I'm not sure if some of you maybe have used that in rest. Two. Because today we don't use visual editors anymore. I mean, our end users, when using WordPress, they are using Classic Editor, or now are using Gutenberg. So this changed, but for them, not for us. So we are using like code. Then in 1999, I become a journalist, which is quite strange, and I'd like to share this part of the story later. In 2003, I started a business, so I was actually a designer from that moment in 2003. I started a business with two of my friends, and when I talk with people here in Nepal, I can see a lot of these similar stories, similar histories from Croatia to Nepal. So in a way, we are all the same, right? Then in 2004, I discovered WordPress. For me as a designer, I needed a CMS that I could easily change, I could easily do all of these different things in there, because I wasn't a developer. Now I know to write some PHP code. I'm not the best PHP coder out there, but then I didn't know anything, so WordPress was the logical choice. In 2005, I became part of Web Standards Movement in Croatia. So from 2003 to 2005, 2 years, in this Web Standards Movement in Croatia, we were a group of really cool designers that were learning from one another. Then in 2009, we started Blogging Brothers, my brother and me. We started to get new interesting jobs, new interesting opportunities. And in 2010, I started talking at conferences. So it took me 7 years to start doing something like that, because talking at conference in front of people, it's not that easy, right? Can those of you who already spoke at a conference or a meetup, can you raise your hand just to see how many of you are in the audience? One, two, maybe you're ashamed. So don't be ashamed to talk at conferences. It can be frightening, but in the end, it's really an amazing opportunity that you can share your stories with people. In 2011, I started visiting conferences abroad. So you must understand, Croatia is not the richest country in the world. Croatia is part of the European Union, but the European Union is among the three poorest countries in the European Union. So we don't have that much opportunity. Going to conferences abroad was really hard for us. We needed to pay extra money to go to London, to Amsterdam, to learn new things. This was in 2011. So Google was available back then. We had a lot of resources, but still we needed to meet new people, we needed to make new connections, so that's when we started going to conferences. And in 2013, it was my first Work in Europe as attendee. So this is the year that Work in Europe started in Leiden, in the Netherlands. Around 800 people from all around the world gathered there. And this is practically some other part of the story where I got deeply involved. workers' community. In 2014, so a few months after Work in Europe, we started and co-founded the Croatian Workers' Community. Today, we have meetups in 5 different cities. We have a workgroup each year that this year was in Zagreb, our capital, and was for 400 attendees. So this is not something, and I'm showing you all this timeline thing, to understand that this is not something that comes overnight. So if in some point you will be thinking, yeah, I can do that because it's hard, it is supposed to be hard. It is not supposed to be that easy. But it can be a really good thing afterwards. So in 2015, I was the lead organizer for the first work in Croatia. This was another experience, and in a way, it helped me connect with other work in organizers. One of them was Petr Rajkovska, a lead organizer for Work in Europe 2016 in Vienna. So this is when I became a co-organizer of Work in Europe as well. So I was like helping organize the biggest workers' conference in the world. In 2016, it was like a really achievement, and in a way a dream come true, because I was really passionate about community and I wanted to do that. So in 2016, I was finally out of my comfort zone, started talking in English, started visiting conferences abroad, and the first conference was not in a country where people don't understand English or don't talk very good English, but it was in London. I went to London to speak English to a bunch of Brits. It was like really frightening for me. But nevertheless, I went there, I gave this talk, I get a lot of positive comments afterwards. Because you need to understand that people... So I know that this is being filmed, so I won't use that word, but people are not bad to each other. If they come to listen to you on the conference, they will like you to comment that you are good. If you are good, they won't say anything if you suck. But even if you suck, it doesn't matter, because next time you can improve, right? This was my story regarding how I became what I am today. And now I'd like to tell you a bit about my process. So my process when we are talking about any project, on that matter, is it consists of 3 phases. The first one is sort of a discovery phase. Let's see if you want to work with that client. So it consists of the first contact, where the client reaches to me or to us. It's over email or recommendation, so on. Then after that, this is something that I try to improve over years, because when I started, I didn't do the second part. This is really, really crucial. Nevertheless, you're a designer or you are a developer, it's really, really crucial to know the client, to understand if this is the kind of a project that you want to work on with him. Because if a project lasts for a month or 3 months or 6 months period, you need to be really comfortable to work on that. Why? Because, as I said earlier, you need to be passionate about that. Then I want to talk about some other thing, how to prepare a quote, how to prepare a good quote. Some tricks I did and how to make a good price for yourself. So I'm not familiar with the average price per hour here in Nepal. So I will give you some estimate prices on some average worldwide price, let's say it like that. And I will want to show you how to price differently based on if you are pricing per hour or weekly or monthly, and what are the benefits of each of that. Then during the projects I have these phases, wireframes and exploration. When I do wireframes, we talk a lot with the client to see what are our shared goals in that project. What is the end goal of the project? Then this is the design phase. And I have after that front-end development and workers development phase. Now, about that. This changed a bit over years. So, at the beginning, when I started working as a company, as a businessman, we used to provide creatives before even asking for a down payment. And this is really stupid. So now I have all these 3 parts designed, where I do some sketch of the one part of the website, and then front-end development and workers development combined in one another. So basically I don't do HTML anymore, I do WordPress theme immediately. And of course I will talk a bit about quality assurance of QA. And what I want to share with you today, and I think that will be most valuable if you are here to listen to that, is how you can make continuous improvements to your relationship with the client, and then how can you turn this relationship into a partnership where you will get more and more recommended. So I think that the last time I took a phone and phoned my clients and asked if I could work on a redesign of their webpage, that was in 2006, I think. So it was more than 12 years ago. After that, every project I got was from recommendation. And you might think that you cannot do that, but you can. Every one of you can do that if you want to do it. Now you're listening to this talk, some of you are smiling, like in the rear end. But nevertheless, you are here to learn new things. And I would like to show you how. So let's start with the first one then. First one can happen in one of these three ways, usually. It can happen in other ways as well, but I will cover these three. Website, email, and recommendation. So let's start with the website. When someone contacts you from the website, you actually don't know them. They could just maybe look at your portfolio, they have been to a website that you already designed, and they arrive to your website, and after that, they just sent a request for a quote, you receive that, and that's it. So based on how you brand yourself, that's the type of jobs you'll get. So when I was doing projects 10 years ago, I was branded as someone who can do everything, who is the best buy, and I cared about quality. So this is the kind of project that I got. It wasn't the best budgets, but still, I got projects where clients wanted good quality in return. A good question is if you want to have a detailed or simple form on your website regarding this quote request. So it all depends. Detailed form is something that's better for you, but in some cases, clients, if they're presented with a detailed form, they may just drop out. They just close your website and move on. What about email? Email is usually more personal. I got emails from new prospective clients when they want to get to work with me. So this is not a recommendation yet, but they have seen my work somewhere and they know maybe the owner of that company or something. They asked and got the email. So this is not actually a recommendation. What I do when I got the request from a website and a request from email, I usually send them a request for a detailed brief. Why? Because I don't want to lose my time before I can see that the client really appreciates what I do and want to work with us, with me. So this is when I sell the detailed brief. Because client that doesn't have 2 hours to answer your brief has either enough money to pay everything you ask or they won't be committed to this project. And this is completely true. I have seen that so many times. Every time that I started to work with a client without sending a request for a detailed brief, I wasn't happy with that project anymore. Let me talk about the third option, recommendation. So when I got a request for a quote from recommendation, usually there's an 80% chance that I will close that deal. Because it's easier to close a deal through recommendation because both sides know what to expect. Let me give you an example. If I'm working with a client, company A, and then this client, company A, has a friend from client, company B, they talk together. And this client A says to client B, yeah, these guys did an amazing job for me, they did me this and this and this and that. And the client B already knows what to expect. And he usually knows what the price they will receive from me. A job you get through a recommendation is usually similar to one that you work on and that got you recommended in the first place, including the price. So this is something that I learned in the past. But what to be aware of when communicating? First of all, professional communication is a must. Explain them everything they ask. Make sure you write your names correctly. When we had a company, we had a really thorough documentation on everything regarding this. Because sometimes it happened that some of the people working for us were not aware of that, so we misspelled names, we made errors like this. And you can change that afterwards, but let me say this, if you are charging too much, clients won't be happy about that. So you must make sure that your communication is quite professional. If you don't want to work with them, and in some cases you don't, tell them immediately, don't waste their time. If you feel the client is stupid, then you are probably the one who is stupid. This is something I completely agree on. You don't call your client stupid, ever. Because if you call that, this is my slip when you are sending an email to your colleagues and it accidentally finishes in your client's email mailbox. But that's just one example. Also, don't forget, and this is really important, you are the expert. If you forget that, you can't expect your client to treat you like you are. So what does basically mean? If you don't project yourself as an expert, then clients won't understand that you are an expert. Whatever you say to them, if you feel like an expert, then they feel that you are right. If you don't feel like an expert, then they will feel that you are wrong. And the second thing, client is paying you to solve his problem. If they forget that, remind them politely. So sometimes clients say to us, yeah, but I'm paying you, do as I say. And then, what I usually do at this, when this happens, I just say, yeah, but you're paying me to solve your problems. If you know the solution, why are you paying me? Right? The second thing, client interview. You need to leave a good first impression. As I said, you're the expert, you're the professional, you know what you are talking about. So you have all the answers because you're an expert. Client interview is a way to see how the client feels about certain things, and you can predict if there will be problems afterwards. So, this is actually the question, one of the questions that arises from this client interview. When I do client interview, I do it always via video or in person if I can, and sometimes I got this feeling that the client can pay much more. But I never actually tried to ask clients for more money. Actually I do, but not in a way that I up the prices just for that client because I feel that they can pay that. What I usually do is give them some options. So I give them some options. I usually give them options of some extra benefits, which I usually don't do in the first place. But if I see, hey, the client can't afford that, why not have something better for the client instead? If you share the same goals, there's a much better chance that the project will be a success, and this will eventually lead to a new recommendation. Again, from 2006, I didn't get any new job when I don't get recommended. So I do everything through recommendations alone. If your goals and client goals are well defined and documented, you will stop a client from owning this project by messing with your business and creative process. So what does this mean is that we need to have shared goals. I never watch a client just as a client. I watch a client as a partner. So what I do with them, before we even start working together, we set some goals. What are your goals? What are your metrics? How will we share the goals? How will we measure the goals? Because then, if you remember when I said earlier, if a client asks, yeah, but I know more of the solution to a problem, and you ask, why are you paying me that? This is what happens if you don't share the same goals. It's important to have shared goals. A good question, should I send a quote immediately after they ask for it? As I said, no, don't do that. Ask for a client interview, ask for a detailed request or a brief. And just after that, when you are sure that you want to work with that client on that project, then you send a quote for that. Mm-hmm. How can a client interview influence the way I prepare a quote? As I said, depending on how much the client can pay, I will give them more options. I'm never ever going to charge more per hour just because I feel the client can pay more. Even today, when I'm working with clients from Croatia and clients from outside Croatia, I have the same pricing for both. Well, Croatian is a little bit smaller, but only 10%. I don't have different pricing based on how much you can pay. This is really important when it comes to underdeveloped countries, because I've seen that so many times when a client from, you name the country, from Western Europe or the States, comes to you and says, yeah, but you are living in Zagreb, in Croatia, and I Googled it, it's not that expensive to live there. Have some of you heard that happening from time? Can you raise your hand? How many of you have heard, yeah, but you live in Nepal, it's cheap to live there, I don't need to pay you that much? Can you raise your hand? Just three of you? Really? Wow. So I heard that a lot of times. What I do, I usually explain this to him. Yeah, I live in Croatia, in Zagreb, it's much cheaper to live there. But eventually I want to travel to conferences. I don't want to work from Croatia alone. By the way, last year I worked for a month from Thailand. And I want to travel the world, I want to meet new people. This is what I really care about. And if you want to work for like less money than I'm asking, then please find some other guy that will help you with that. And I totally don't have problems with that approach, because if someone is trying to ask for less money, then this is not the kind of person I want to work with. And this is not only about him respecting me, this is also about me respecting myself. What if I don't want to work with this specific client? This happens. So we have this small print in all our quotes that we don't want any down payment and we don't want to start work on a project before the client interview. Because it happened in the past that during the client interview, I realized that this is not the kind of a client that I want to work with. In some cases, it was because the client wanted too much, or in some cases even too little, because why I want to work with a client that doesn't have the bigger walls, if I had the bigger walls, right? If you're not happy with the work you're doing, then most certainly the client won't be happy with that work as well. Remember when I said about how to work as a designer, that you need to be passionate about it, that you need to be emotional? This is what I meant. And this is this other thing that you need to be aware of. You might think that a client interview is to protect your client or yourself. No, it's here to protect both sides. Because, again, as I said, if you're not comfortable working on that project, then you will be nothing more than a code monkey who will write some code and design some stuff, and eventually you won't be happy with that. Or maybe you will, but then you definitely miss the profession. Because the thing of being a designer is not about just doing the thing that I will tell you. It's about being a better person to learn and innovate and educate yourself. So let's talk about preparing a quote. First of all, about how to define your own prices. So these are the example prices. I started at base hourly rate. So this is a price when someone drops me an email and says, hey, I have this 2-hour thing I need you to work for me. Nevertheless, it's, I don't know, some small change, something I can't do that myself. But what I don't like, and I could, my hour rate is actually a bit higher, and I'm thinking about making it even more higher. I don't want to work on a project that lasts for 2 hours. I want to work on a project that lasts at least a week, and even more, maybe a month. So what I usually do to clients when they reach out to me and ask, hey, can you give me a quote for something? I usually do everything in like daily price. This is my base price. It is like 50 hours per hour per day. So I don't want to work on something for less than a day because I cannot be committed to that. Then if someone asks for a week, then it's even lower price. And then again, if I am asked to work for a project, on a project for a month, then it will be even lower price. Here are my hourly rates that are currently for both Croatian and worldwide clients. I know for some people it may seem high, for some people it may seem low. If you're coming from the States, then you would say maybe, yeah, $80 per hour, like I would pay to work for me and I would charge $160. I don't know what's the hourly rate. But you don't need to be afraid to set your hourly price. When I started in 2003, my first project that I landed was for around $200, more or less. My hourly rate back then was $10. And then from time to time, I started to rise it up. I rise it to 50, to 20, to 30, to 40, to 60, now it's around 80. But there are a couple of things that you need to remember. Remember when I said about recommendation system. If a client recommends you to another client, you cannot raise the price of that project from, I don't know, 20-hour hourly rate to 40-hour hourly rate, because it will feel wrong. What I usually do and did in that kind of situations, I usually try to rise this hourly rate in a smaller amount, like 20%, maybe not more than that. This is something every client will agree on without any problems. And eventually you will come to a bigger hourly rate. Now, about this hourly rate, one other thing. You feel maybe that this is something you can never get to. Who feels that you can never get to this hourly rate? Are there any persons in this room that feels that they cannot get $80 per hour? Leaving is working from Nepal. Everyone believes that. That's great, but I'm not sure what I'm doing to do that. But what if the clients can't pay more? As I said, instead of sending them a high price because they can't pay more. So what extra benefits you can offer them and use that to upsell them some other services. When you are in a good way with your clients, then they will come back to you, then they will ask for something else, they will recommend you. When this happens, you will month by month or year by year rise your hourly prices. And this is what you are aiming to, right? Not like to work like I did entire year for $10 per hour. That's not the point. The point is to have a really good life and do whatever you like to do. How to define a budget? These are my percentages. So it all depends on project, but for usual workers project, this is something I do. I always have 10% project management fee. I ended up with project management fee maybe 3 years ago. Before that, I didn't have project management fee, but what happened is that clients constantly pinged me and asked me something, and then I realized I did lose a lot of money in that process. So with project management fee, this is a way to get that money with me. Also, 30% on design, 30% on development. As I said, I usually calculate the project as a budget. So when I have a budget, do I need to shout maybe more because you can hear me, it seems, right?
No, it's okay.
So if I have a budget of some sort, then 60% is for design and development. If I freelance on that job, then this is all my share. I can do a really lot of things with this 60%. Then 10% is on SEO, 10% of the project budget at least needs to be on SEO. If it means hiring a remote company that will work on SEO, or you can do it yourself, then that's your choice. But I'd say 10% on SEO, 20% on content or copyright. So what impacts the final budget? For me, it impacts if I have the same goals as the client. Sometimes I'm not for tying up and making a price bigger, but if I don't feel like working on that project, if I will have a stomach pain every morning during that project, then I need to have a really good way, why am I doing that? So in that case, I will have the budget. The second most important thing is if the client will allow me my creative freedom. If I am not creative in the process, then I don't have a passion to work on it. I'm not emotionally attached to that project. I don't want to work on that. And the third thing is, has the client tried to bargain for a lower price? Now, this is my favorite. Some clients try to bargain on a lower price, and I really hate that. When this happens, like, I usually don't work with that client. Sometimes clients just try to fish for a couple of quotes. So they're sending a request for quote to this company, to that company, to that company. So when I give them a quote after the client interview, and then they say, yeah, but you're too expensive. We will try with some other company. And then 3 months later, bam, they are back. Because the other company didn't deliver what they promised. What happens then? I usually up the budget for 20%. And if the client asks me why that happened, I say, yeah, my prices got bigger. So are there any questions regarding this first phase? All clear? We can go on. Wow, we are 40 minutes. So project is approved, now what? Preparation phase needs to start before a project. So in this phase, I ask a couple of questions. Did the client prepare all the website content? And does the client have a dedicated content person for the project? Someone who can make decisions. Both of these are really important. Nevertheless, you are a designer or a business owner or whatever. Because if the client didn't prepare all the website content, in 99% of the cases, you will breach the deadline. 99% of the cases. If the client doesn't have a dedicated person who you can contact with, and I'm talking primarily on big multinational companies, then you have a problem in the commanding chain, someone needs to approve that, the project gets delayed, it all depends. But this is what I have been observing in the past years. What and how to prepare yourself. So first of all, when I had a company, when I managed a couple of people as a project manager, first I prepared my own team. Not every designer or every developer or every content writer is good for this project. I try to find the best team for the client. Second, we need to define types of communication with the client, email, Skype, Teamwork. This is the communication tool that I use. If a client says, yeah, but I'm not sure if we need to have Skype and we need to call all these emails. I want to call you or I want to send you emails. No, because that impacts the budget. If you want that, sure, we can top up the budget and we can do that. I can email and answer your emails 4 hours per day. It's not a problem. You will pay me. I will answer your emails. If that doesn't happen, then you need to work with our process. We improved our process over time, so you need to learn how to work on that. The key to that is communication. So here are a couple of tips on how to be a good communicator. So communication happens through these channels: email, voice and video conferences, project management tools, and screencast. So first of all, email. This is the most used communication channel. Clients love that a lot. From the first contact when they send you an email, to working with you on a project. If a client constantly bombards you with emails, then some things you will miss. That's for sure. That's why we have project management tools after all. But email is good because it leaves a written trail. I found this useful on so many occasions. Written trail is really important because it is here for your own protection. When you have video calls or whatever, God will give you that example later. You need to have written for what you have discussed. Because this is the only way when a client cannot say, yeah, but I don't want to discuss that and we agreed on that. No, a written trail is a must. Though it's slower than a call, so it's not that perfect. In most cases, I like to do voice and video conferences. So I always go for a video call. Except if it is a lot of connection, I don't do video calls then. But if I can, it's always a video call. Calls are good because they help speed up the solution to a problem. Let's say that you are stuck with something. You need to get in touch with a client to make a fast solution to a problem that you have. You call it on Skype or Google Hangouts or whatever platform you use. Appearing is quite popular lately or soon. And I can talk with a client and in 2 minutes I can solve a problem that I would lose 2 or 3 days over email or even over project management. But after the call is over, remember to send an email. Just to make sure, hey Joe, hey John, hey Ed, we discussed these things, this was what we agreed on. That's it. One of my favorite, if not the most favorite project tools, and I tried a lot of project management tools from Basecamp to ActiveCollab to Trello to, I'm not sure of other project management tools, but I tried it a lot. We used Basecamp for so many years. Then we discovered Teamwork. Teamwork has many advanced options, although the user interface is quite clean and straightforward. But Teamwork can cover everything from smaller to bigger projects. Nevertheless, if you are working on a multinational project or you're working on a project for a small family-owned company, we use Teamwork every time. Because if you make a mistake and you say, yeah, I don't want to use a project management tool, we can do it over email. I did that mistake a few months ago when I was working for a big Croatian company that was throwing a conference, and I said, yeah, that's a one-page website, nothing can go wrong, we want to use Teamwork. Then 2 weeks afterwards, I realized that a lot of things can go wrong and we are much slower with email, so we use Teamwork. It has time tracking, which is a great thing. If you are tracking your time and sending these invoices, it has a really cool report which you can attach to your client, and it starts with $9 per user per month, if you do mind it. So here's Teamwork.
My job is to bring clients' ideas to life. I oversee a lot of projects here, and Teamwork helps me keep track of what's going on and what I have to do next. I can see what tasks my team and I have on each day to keep our projects moving forward. With Teamwork, I can plan whole projects with my clients, even on a computer. You can say it's my business in the cloud. I can see Dave has big ideas.
I have big ideas.
It's team over here. I assign tasks to the team so everyone is kept in the loop and nothing gets lost in people's inboxes.
If I have any questions, I can quickly receive answers. Keeps the project warm. Then, if I need any extra assistance, I can sign a task to a colleague or something.
Even though I'm not in the office, I always feel connected. When I complete a job, I can upload the files and notify the team.
I usually know a couple of files
people. With a Rainbow mobile app, I can see what's happening wherever I am. Teamwork also allows me to keep items private, so I can show them to my clients when I'm ready.
I think the logo needs to be bigger.
Teamwork also makes it simple to adjust the project for any unexpected changes. Teamwork allows me to keep track of all the time we spend working on projects. I can then push this to our billing app, and we get paid. With the company calendar, it's easy to know when events are happening. And with SMS reminders, we never miss a beat.
It's party time.
Teamwork.com. It's project management made easy.
Other tool is Trello. I don't use Trello that much. I use Trello for community-based projects where we work on organizing conferences or meetups. But I really believe that Trello is the best free project management tool in the world. Because it's free, it has a little bit different concept, so you don't use tasks, you use cards, you have the cons, so you can save something that is, for example, in progress, something that you're working on, improvement, and so on. Each card, you can add users, tags, checklists, deadlines, so on. So here's an example of Trello. Do you know what Screencast is? So, I didn't use Screencast before, but 2 years ago when I started freelancing again after opening a company and again going on my own, I realized that Screencast is the best way to stay in the loop with the client, and it's like a replacement for an in-person session. This is a deal where I have a problem and I need to explain something to a client. For example, we have worked on a new piece of UI and I need to explain what I did. And this is a good solution because my client can see that for himself. If I'm a part of a bigger team, for example, if I'm just designer of user interface, then this screencast can be seen by developers as well. So this is why I like screencast. And I like to keep archives of all screencasts that I did, because this is to keep track of a project's progress. So I'll also give an example of a screencast I did for a client from Texas.
I think there are two things to show you today.
So I'll start with the register part.
So what I'm doing is I'm explaining the changes that I made to certain parts of it.
Message part, so if there's a right background, there is a
success. My defense, I can say that I was quite tired, which is the long day.
Nothing much to see there. On watchlist, I made a couple of adjustments, so I added this column. When was the property added to watchlist, so we have this column here. And basically, it starts, you can add column after this one, so you cannot add column in the address in the edit. That's something that you cannot change. Other than that, it's the same as the other day. So if this is enough frame, we I suggest that we stick with it. The last thing is, well, the thing that I worked the most in the last couple of days. So if you go to the property, you have the standard view here, nothing changed in the first, second, and but if you look at the ARV tab, you get the what?
Blah, 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 blah. For me, Screencast is the perfect way to make clients see the loop. So whatever change we make, this is the perfect way to have it spent in life. It's like kind of standing beside me, watch what I do, and we talk in person. So, from time to time, you will have some critical parts of the project. For example, you did more work than you were expected to, and you don't know how to communicate that to a client. Some unexpected delays, this happened on most projects. And there are communication problems within the projects. So what I do, I always, really always, I'm not sending an email in that situation, I'm always communicating via video call. Why? Because I want to see client's reaction to when I talk with him. In crisis communication, you need to observe, you need to be sort of a psychologist. You need to, like, when we are talking together, we are talking, we are exchanging words, but then your face changes. If you are not happy, I can see that you are not happy. If you are pissed off because of something, I can see that. This is why I never communicate anything that is as a critical decision if I'm not seeing the person. One other thing, when answering emails, be polite. Sometimes client can send you a hate email because he's pissed off because of you missed the deadline. If you haven't communicated that in advance, you need to understand that clients is pissed for a reason. If you communicated that in advance, then you can answer the email really politely because you are building a partnership between you and the client. Deadlines get missed from time to time. This happens in a lot of projects for many reasons. If the content is not ready, if we are waiting for another person, another party, for many reasons. When this happens, we need to communicate. We need to be really open to our clients. So let's go to wireframes and exploration. What I do for exploration, I do part of the exploration myself. I go to see the client's competition. I like to see what they did good, what they did not that good. I'm not copying. I'm just trying and observing and analyzing. Also, what I like to do is to ask my clients, hey, send me the websites that you like. Send me the websites that you don't like. But what I ask them, it's not just to send me a link without any explanation. I need to know what you like on the website or what you don't like on the website. Is that a navigation? Is that how the mouse moves over the website? I don't know, it can be anything. I want to know why, because this will help me to create a good design. Also, I like to start by asking my client for a site plan. They usually do have an idea what will their website be about. So this is a good time to ask for assignments. I usually tell them, if you don't have all the content ready, you need to have a assignment at least, because before you supply me with a assignment, you won't start. Because assignment is important if you are designing user interface, if you are designing any interaction, if you're doing any information architecture, you need to know what you are focusing on. And also, I really like to work closely with the client on this because this is the only way that we can build a really good product and a really good website together. This is an example when we did the biggest open source project in Croatia. It was open source for a third largest city in Croatia. They decided to build a new web portal using WordPress. So then we decided to open source everything and I did work a lot. Now, you can see this, we didn't do that much, we're just observing the screen. But what we're actually doing, this was a 4-hour meeting with breaks, of course. But we did discuss in very, very many details the sighting and how the new website will look like. And we especially focused on one other thing, information architecture. Because similar to sighting, working on a good information architecture on a web page will make sure that end client don't get lost. Eventually working towards a defined goal. If it is more sales or better and easier, management of the website or easier, visitor funnel and funneling to the website and so on. It can be anything. But it's really important to work with the client to explain that to him or her if possible. And then I go to wireframes. I define many elements of a web page, see which one are repeated on different sub pages, because these are the things that I will usually design. You can work whatever you like, actually, on paper, on an app, on a whiteboard. There are a couple of different things what you can do. You can do it like this, if this is some small website. You can do it like this, if this is something you do, like the one open source project I mentioned you about that had, I don't know how many templates. And you can do a quick sketch on a whiteboard. So these last two, the wireframes and the whiteboard, I used that when I was working on that open source project I mentioned. Why I use both and not only one? Because let's say that you are deciding on some of the elements of the page. This is like one particular element that you were deciding on. I don't want to like go into too much details. I just want to sketch it real fast to see if this sticks. If it sticks, then yeah, I will do more detailed wireframe. And I can do even better wireframes than this, but there's no point. Usually I don't send wireframes to my clients, I just give it for myself. Things you need to define, who is the client's target audience? In this open source project, this was the citizens of the city. We wanted to make the city website more appealing to them. We wanted to make it easier for them to find things on the website. These are our target audience. Other target audience was that we wanted to make the website of a city government as transparent as possible. So another target audience was journalists. We wanted to make everything open for public, so we didn't want to have any secrets with the public. So this was another target audience. We defined that during this phase. Because when you know your target audience, you know how to approach them, on what to put focus on. If you are building a sales website, then you will focus on landing pages, probably. If you are building a news website, then you might focus on two things, either category listing or article listing, these two things. What are the most important pages of clients' website? I'd say I usually start with a home page. This is the first page that people land on using Google or any other search engine or something else if they just type the home page. I usually do design a couple of other things like the style guide. This is a page with a lot of things that we use like headings, tables, lists, drop downs, forms, and so on. So these are the pages that I usually design. A couple of things for further reading, and by the way, no need to write this down because you have the presentation afterwards. What about design? So this is another phase. I did the wireframes, now I'm going into design phase. First of all, I use client's branding for visual inspiration. How are the photos used in client's branding? What kind of typography? Is it serif? Is it sans serif? What kind of colors has been used? What's the kind of message? Is the message shorter or the client wants to have a bigger message? Because I need to know all these details before I start designing the thing. And you need to be emotional and passionate about what you design, because emotion and passion is something the client will see from how you talk and present your design. And one other thing that I haven't mentioned in these slides. So, no matter what you do here, it's important that you know your process. Some clients will ask you to design a whole bunch of pages in Photoshop or Sketch. You can do that. But I usually do projects per budget. So I don't do hourly, I usually do per budget. I define a budget, I say what will I do in that. And if clients want to have like 10 different templates in 3 or 4 different breakpoints, then they need to pay for that. Usually I don't do that. I do a smaller budget. I gave them a smaller budget so I can work on that. I usually design only 1 or 2 pages and in desktop only version. So I don't design responsive. Now, this may be tricky if you are working with a client for the first time, but as I said earlier, I do everything through recommendation. So I have this sort of experience with it, so I can design on the desktop version of the page because this is something that they will see on their desktop computers, and then when I do HTML and WordPress, I do mobile first approach, starting with a responsive design, but I have already the vision of how the desktop version will look like. So I have two examples that I'd like to show you. One is the sketch file. So this is for a project that I've been working on. So this is, so this is how I basically do all my templates here. I start with, for example, I started with dashboard because we realized that this is the easiest template to start with. We decided on a couple of things like header bar, how the navigation will work, and so on. And then we started to work towards everything else. You see elements that are repeating itself. You see search, and so on and so forth. But what's really important in here is everything I do, practically I do it like this. I start small by building small components, and then I use these components to do bigger modules. So for example, the biggest challenge of this project was how to make the page remove the complexity for having different pages based on what you're searching for. So this is the search part. This is a project for big telecom companies. They are using that to track complaints from customers. So this is sort of a help desk solution. And we could do that in many different ways. We saw what the competition can do. We saw that the complexity in their solutions is not the best one. A lot of representatives of telecom companies use that software, but they weren't that happy about it. We wanted to save time, so we combined everything into this simple part here, where we started with how to add another case, how to add another search, how to add tags, and so on. So this is something that we did for almost a week. This one small, simple part to make it perfect. The other thing I want to show you is how I do my Photoshop files. So in preparing Photoshop file, the biggest problem I see with so many people is that their files are not prepared very well. They all have all these layers not being named and so on. So what you want to do, you need to have a structure, like sort of a folder-like structure where you can see all this really fast. And I'm sorry I cannot show you this in more details. It's a bit buggy. So, sorry about that, I couldn't show you the photo, but what I wanted to say is that you can change your process over time. Like, my first Photoshop file was a mess. I did the layers, I have all, so many untitled layers or new layer and so on and so forth. I didn't take into consideration that some other people may use this Photoshop file and work on that. When you realize that it's you're not alone, it's other people can work on that after you, then you start noticing these things and you improve yourself. How to present your creatives. If you're presenting a new creative or just hitting the mouse, then you need to add extra effort. And this is really important, especially for projects with a high budget. So whenever possible, do a presentation live, over video conference call, or via screen sharing, and observe clients' reaction. So presenting a creative is an important task. Don't underestimate it, as it can literally kill the project. I have seen so many times when I didn't put much effort into presenting it to these creatives that the creative eventually wasn't approved and we needed to stop the project altogether. So you need to put some extra effort. I will show you a couple of examples on how I do that. I'll start with a logo as an example. For that. This is a presentation for a new logo for a small company from my hometown. I add all these effects, I usually don't add effects, but I know clients love that, so I add some effects. I start with why they need rebranding, blah, and then I go to tell a few things about them. I know they don't know that, but nevertheless, this is the way you start. Then, what are they, how are they, what are their, what are they bullet points? Are they an expert in a field and so on? And then I practically what I do, I build the tension. I explain how I design the logo. So I analyze logos in the same industry. I use Sans typography because a lot of these competitors use Sans typography and so on. And I decided eventually that eventually, I decided to go with a font, which I will do some spell changes to. I did rebranding using this specific color that I rebranded into a bit different value because they needed to have this this link with a past branding. It was a 25-year-old company after all, so they needed this thing. And eventually, I started explaining what font, what are the possibilities that we could use from the fonts that I choose. You can see that I didn't go with Serif anymore because I decided I would go with Sans. Then, of course, I explained that I want to go uppercase for a reason, and then about the color. The old one, the new one, and then you need to build attention. This is the most important part of the project, the time when they see their new logo. So you need to look at their eyes and to see their reaction, if they like it or they don't like it. And the new logo is... You are practically building attention here. And it can go, this is the second version, a symbol also, you build tension. Another example, how they work together. Example 1, example 2, B1, B2, variations like negative, black and white, regular, and so on and so forth. Now, this is example when I present a logo. What happens if I present something else? So what happens if I want to present a new web page? So this is for one of the biggest Croatian IT companies. They have 300 people with offices in Croatia and abroad. And I started to redesign their website. They had the old website. They were aware that it's not good. And now I present a new solution. The first part is the same. When presenting a logo, when presenting a new solution. I start with why, who they are, what they think of themselves. I did all these animations. I'm not that proud about these animations, but I know the clients love that, so I added that. What was our approach? And then the new design. And now, when I say new design to them, they usually have a blank page. I need to build attention. And then I wait for a couple of seconds, and when they are really nervous, they want to see that, then I click and show them the new design. With some subtle effects, I explain the first part, the bottom part, then we go to see the whole page. Then I can show them some parts with some nice animations, explaining each and every part of the new design. And you might laugh about that, but this works every time. If you do it like that, it works every time. Because they see your professionalism, they see your passion, they see that you're emotional about the new website. And you can go on and on, and you can explain other parts of the web page, you can give them variations, and so on. But what happens when you have a different kind of solution? So I'm showing you the final thing, and this is about that biggest open source project I was mentioning about. So now I'm sitting in a big meeting place. Around the table is me from one side, the mayor of the city, government officials on the other side, they are all really important. They all have their suits, their ties. I came up with a hoodie because I'm a designer, I'm a creative person. And then I start to talk. What are the goals? What are the phases? Because this is a project that lasted for 2 years. I need to explain the phases so they understand that. We are focusing on these 2 phases now, we are presenting this. How are the citizens involved? This is important because one of the focus of the redesign was to involve citizens in the design decision process. We did a poll, so we had a survey with the citizens, they answered, I'm presenting the result as well. So this is not the simple explanation of the new design, this is a sort of a process builder. We are building toward the point where I will show them the new design. And as you can see, I can talk without problems. So what the citizens say, I'm just using quotes from the citizens, and citizens say, yeah, the page cannot be searched at all. We want more information on what is happening in the city. We can't seem to find that anywhere. Whatever I searched for, it was really hard for me that I decided not to be on your website anymore. Everything what citizens says is bad, you know? They feel bad. They know that they need a new design. Information are old. So what was our approach? I'm explaining. I'm showing you the same photos that I showed you earlier. I'm explaining every part. We are having the conference with other mayors from other cities in Croatia. I'm explaining why are we doing these wireframes and in what way. I'm explaining how we talk with the citizens, how I work with them with the wireframes, how I explain the whole process, how we ask for their opinion on that. And then it comes the thing that we are all looking for, the new design. And this is it, this is the new web page. The old one was really, really bad. And see the subtle animations. Animations are not that hard, but it shows that I really did something more. Like, I did my best to present that to them. And in Keynote, or in any other presentation software, this can be done in 5 minutes. But the thing is, that with these subtle things that you can do that don't take much time, you can gain much more with the client. Now the second page and so on and so on. What about front-end developers? So as I said earlier, things that we do, we used to do it in different ways. So our process changed over time. Nowadays, I do front-end development and WordPress development in one. So I don't have this, but I will show you how we usually prepared the style guides, how we usually prepare the HTML for some of the projects we worked on. So for the project for telecom companies, this is the style guide, all the colors, general typography, user content, lists, tables, image examples, icons that we use with a really quick code that you can actually use, forms, and so on. There's a lot of this information in here. And eventually, if you go to cases, this is the part that is the most important for them. And this is all like simple HTML and simple jQuery. It's not that much work, but it's really important for them to see how the things work in the final environment, because developers will like eventually get to this. The developers need to see how this works, because if you give them enough information, then the possibility of something getting done wrong, it's almost remote. And for another example, the city of Rijeka. Basically, go and browse to every template. So, your process can be different. This is ours. This is just an example. You can do it differently if you want. It's not a problem. So, I'm just showing you a couple of examples from our process. What about WordPress development? So, whatever I do, I define deadlines to be at least 20% longer. Why? When I talk with developers, or when I do deadlines myself, I know from my experience that a lot of things can go wrong over time. If it is a project lasts longer, then the greater is the possibility that something will actually go wrong. So, add a 20% deadline and communicate that to your client. You can match your deadlines, you can make your own deadlines shorter. So for example, if you say something will be done by the in the first week of April, but you know that you will probably do it in the last week of March, then that's okay. But the client needs to know that this is the first week of April that we are talking about. And one other thing that I do a weekly or bi-weekly recap of the project together with the client. We talk. We just see if everything is going okay, if there is a blocker, a stopper that we need to be aware of. So at that point, we know that something is going wrong and we need to react immediately. Which is something that is also good. I'm not sure about your process, but this is mine. I like to be transparent. I add my client to our keyword, I add it to our Dropbox, I add to a development server so they can see what's going on every single day. Whenever we push something, the client can see that. That's important to build trust. Even if something goes wrong, if you miss a deadline, trust is the most precious value you have with your client. So build trust by allowing them, constantly communicating with them, and allowing them access to your development server, to your codes, to everything, to Bitbucket, to GitHub, whatever you want. If a project is too big, it's better that only your project manager and client's dedicated person will be in touch. Usually for our projects, nevertheless, if it is a big one or a small one, if a team works on a project, every person in the team can communicate with the client directly. There's no rule against that. If I have a problem, I'm communicating that with the client. But if something is out of my reach, I asked my project manager, which usually was myself, which was I, when I became an agency, and then I would communicate that with a client. It's always good to have two zones, like the developer or designer, and then a project manager, because if a designer or a developer says something that the client doesn't appreciate in a way, because, I don't know, maybe they are not the best communicators out there, then there is another level, see that like a second support level that can deal with the client. And then if a project manager cannot work on that, then there is a company owner that takes over and does the trick. Q&A. So, both companies leave Q&A for the end. What I do, I don't like to leave Q&A for the end. 10% of my project time goes for Q&A, so I do tests often and I do tests early. This is important because I want to keep my projects on track, I want to keep my projects error-free. If I do tests like now and not wait for project end, then I know the problem and I will resolve it immediately. I had people working for me, and one of their favorite words were, we'll take care of that later. You know in how many cases that never happened? In most all the cases, you don't want to leave that for later. Are there any questions regarding this problem? Do you want to add a mic?
No, no. So, you talk about adding clients to the project management program. So, doesn't that create a chaos? Because once client has access to the project management group, they start taking over the project, including your developers, your designers, and not communicate properly with the project managers.
It's a good question. So the question was if our clients have been added to project management tool, is there a worry that their client will take over the project? It might happen. This is why the client interview is important. If I think that the client could take over the project, then I'll stop him from doing that. I might not add them to project management, or I might not add them to teamwork. But if I feel like the client's presence there can benefit both him and us, then by all means I will add him to that. But when clients is there, there needs to be some rules. One of the first rules, don't interfere with the process. So a client can see everything, they can go to that, but they're not allowed to comment. So if I'm mentioning directly clients, then of course I expect some comment from them. But if not, they can oversee everything, but they cannot act on it. Are there any other questions regarding this phase? No. So what about continuous improvements? A lot of people say when we finish the projects, we don't want to work with the client anymore. This is okay, I believe. If you don't want to work on better projects, it's okay to finish the project and after that just forget about everything. If you are not invested in that project. Then again, I think in that case, it's you missed the job. You are doing the wrong job. Actually, when you're done with the main project, offer some additional things if they make sense. If you can do something for free and it won't take much of your time, do it. You will win a client for good. In many cases, I did something for free. Like, it's not a big deal. Like, a code change in some phase of the project that I wouldn't do a code change afterwards. Maybe it's some small thing that will take me 2 hours or maybe 2 days, but if it's 2 days on a 6 month project, then it's not a big deal. And this works with every client from every culture. Some cultures are different, so maybe people in Germany won't appreciate that, that much, and I'm just talking like in my head, that might not be true. And then some people from Croatia might appreciate that. But nevertheless, if you can do something good, and you can do it without taking that out from your own toll, then do it. It will be a really good for a client agency relationship. And this comes to our last part. It builds partnership. Doing a project like that, if you're honest to your clients, they will be your partners in this and future projects. If you're honest, if you add it to your project management tools, if you're communicating often, if you don't have problems explaining and answering their questions, no matter how stupid these questions might seem, then you will win that as your future partner. Offer the bonuses, something that is small to you but can mean a lot to them. For example, they might forget about something. A lot of times my clients forget about designing a newsletter because we never discuss that. And then they usually come to me and say, yeah, we need some newsletters, can you send me a tool for that? And I say, hey, come on, we'll do it for free. It's no big deal. We have a budget. It's not a problem to make us a small thing. We worked for a Ministry of Labor in Croatia 3 or 4 years ago. 2 weeks back, I was buying some stuff for coming to Nepal, like I think trekking shoes or something like that. And secretary of Ministry of Labor calls me and asks, hey, it seems that you designed our website. We have a problem, something needs to be changed. We asked our technicians, but our technician said that they cannot change that. It wasn't true, but still, they said they cannot change that. And I said, sure, send me an email. I was really clear. You know that you don't have any support from us, but still, if I can help you, I will help you. Just send me an email and we will see what we can do. And an hour later, the email was in my inbox. It wasn't that clear, so I phoned the secretary and I talked with her. And in 10 minutes over the phone, we fixed the problem. Something that their technicians couldn't fix for days. So 10 minutes. When they asked, can you send us an invoice? I said, come on, this is 10 minutes. It will take you more time to prepare an invoice and send it to you. And it will be more bigger cost for me to do that than not to send you an invoice. They were like really shocked because no one does that in Croatia. No one loses the opportunity to take money from the government. I lost that opportunity. Though, a week later, they came back, asked for more, and now we are negotiating about the price for these changes. This is just one example. There are a lot of different examples to that. Making a partner out of your clients means they will have better understanding of you as they're becoming part of the family. This proven truth on so many occasions. You were having a couple of years ago financial problems. You were exposed to Croatian clients. You didn't work with clients outside Croatia that much. We did a lot of financial difficulties back then. We reached out to our clients saying, hey, we have these financial problems. I'm not sure what will happen with us. You don't need to worry about that. We will always be here for you, but we might not take new projects, so stop recommending us. Their response was overwhelmingly positive because of all that, because of all our approach, because they were sort of part of the family. And this all goes in a one big circle, but we are all happy, we are doing good, we are doing something we like. Every day I wake up in the morning and I'm really happy about the day that is to come. Even today, I wasn't doing design, but I did, and I do something that I love, I talk with you guys. So this is really important for me, and this is really important to understand your client-agency relationship. This should be a partnership that you can build upon. Are there any questions about this part? And I promise we are really close to the end. No questions? I can go? Okay, some other tools I would recommend. Dropbox, if you're not using Dropbox to sync files between the team or between you and the client, use that. Toggle, if you need an app to track your time, use Toggle. It's a really good app for time tracking. Rescue Time is a Mac app. It has a free version. If you have a Mac, this is the app that you need to have on your Mac. Why? Because it tracks the time you spend on your Mac. If you're on Facebook, if you're on Twitter, if you're on Instagram, if you're on a stupid news portal that you don't want to be on, this app tracks everything. And at the end of the week, it gives you the overview of your activity, how productive you are. This really helped me a lot to be more productive. One Passport, this is a Mac app, iOS app, so if you are in an Apple ecosystem, this is a Passport Manager that I recommend. There are other things, like other Passport Managers, like Last Passport, yeah. So you can use that as well. For optimization, Optimizely, if you are running into, if you're running A/B tests, then Optimizely is a good start. We don't use these tools on every project, but on some projects we might use them. Hotjar, which offers amazing analytics after you publish your website on the behavior of your visitors. Then Crazy Egg, which creates heat maps, scroll maps, and much more. So this is something that you can offer your clients as an upsell. You can say to them, yeah, I will, we will do a redesign after some time, and you will be using these tools to do that, to see what is something that you need to focus on. Also, Google Analytics. If you don't use Google Analytics or some other analytics tools, then you are in a big problem. PageSpeed Insights, when you are building a new website, just check if this PageSpeed is good enough. Interaction with visitors, two things that I personally use, SurveyMonkey, not that much anymore to be honest, and MailChimp, sending email campaigns, and to MailChimp with clients as well. So now I'd like to tell you about my missing year. In 1999, I just finished high school, I was 18 years old, and I got the opportunity to work on television as a journalist. So I took that opportunity. I interviewed a lot of famous people in Croatia and in the region. I interviewed movie actors, I interviewed presidents, prime ministers, ministers. And what was problematic in that, before I opened my own company, so this is a period of 3 years, my ego was like driving me crazy. I thought that I was better than others. I'm not sure if you know that feeling, but at some point in your life, you might think that you know everything. But there is just one simple truth, you don't. Whatever you think you know now, in 10 years you'll probably see that you were a fool. And I can tell that this period of life changed me a lot. So, even today I really like writing articles, I do communication for Work Keeps Europe. This is really important to me. But these 3 years, it really made me a better person, it made me understand that we are all equal, and that we can all, by ourselves, by our decisions, things that we do every day, that we could impact on our future. So I'd like you to share this video with you. I just found out about it a few days ago. I think you know this guy. Maybe you have seen this video, but let's watch it together.
People ask me all the time, what is the secret to success? And I always tell them, but the short version is, you gotta have a 22-inch biceps. And you gotta be able to kill predators with your bare hands. And of course, you gotta have this charming Austrian accent. That's a given. The long version is that I actually always had 5 rules. You don't need to be a bodybuilding champion. You don't even need to want to be an action hero or anything like that. If you want to excel in whatever you do, those rules are for you. So the first rule is find your vision and follow it. If you don't have a goal, if you don't have a vision, you just drift around. You're not going to be happy. I grew up after the Second World War. Austria, right along with Germany, lost the Second World War. There was, of course, depression. There was a terrible economic situation. I wanted to get out of there. I wanted to escape. And luckily, one day in school, I watched a documentary about America. I knew exactly that is where I wanted to end up. The question was just, how do I get there? How do I get to America? No one had the money to travel or anything. But for one day, I was fortunate enough to see a bodybuilding magazine. And on the cover was this very muscular guy. Mr. Universe becomes Hercules Star. His name was Rich Hawk. I read the article as fast as I could, learning about how he grew up in Leeds in England, poor, and how he trained 5 hours a day, every single day, and trained and trained and trained, and then finally became Mr. Great Britain. And then became Mr. Universe. Then he won a second Mr. Universe title, and a third Mr. Universe title, and then all of a sudden he landed in Rome in Chinachita, doing Hercules service. And as I read, I became more and more certain. I had that vision very clearly laid out, to be a champion on that same stage where he wanted Mr. Universe. And then to move to America, then get into movies. From that moment on, everything that I did, no matter how hard I had to work or how much I had to struggle, it didn't matter, because I knew what the purpose was. And I found my passion. Always discover your vision, and the rest will follow. Now my second rule is, never ever think small. You have to go and shoot for the stars. I didn't just think about being in movies. No, I wanted to be a movie star. I wanted to have above the title billing. I wanted to become the highest paid entertainer. I basically wanted to be another John Wayne. What's wrong with that? Never think small. Think big. The third rule is, ignore the naysayers. I think it is natural that when you have a big vision and big dreams, and you have big goals, that people are going to say around you, I don't think it can be done. I think it's impossible. I mean, it started right away when I was 15 years old and I became a bodybuilder. Right after that happened, I said, I want to be a world champion in bodybuilding. I want to be Mr. Universe. They immediately said, are you crazy? Bodybuilding is an American sport. Forget about it. It's nuts. And then when I wanted to go into show business, after I won 13 world championship titles in bodybuilding, I said, I want to be like Reg Park. I want to be a Hercules. I want to get into movies. Well, I tell you, when I met those agents and managers, their reaction was, oh, that is so funny. You want to be what, a leading man? Oh, come on. I mean, look, first of all, let's start with your body. You're gigantic. You're like a monster. And then your accent always gives me the chills just listening to your German bullshit. Come on now. Have you ever seen an international movie star with a German accent? It doesn't happen. Forget about that. And then your name, what is it, Schwarzen Schnitzel or something like that? People are going to storm the theater and the movie houses because Schwarzen Schnitzel is starring in a movie. Oh yeah, I can see that already. Imagine that. Everywhere I turned, they said, no, it won't happen, it's not going to happen, and forget about it. Luckily, I did not listen. I started taking acting classes, English classes, even accent removal classes. I ran around all day saying lines like a fine wine grows on a vine. All of a sudden, I got a little break. All of a sudden, I got a TV show. A little part, then another little part, and then pumping out and stay hungry, and then of course I landed the big role of Conan the Barbarian. So finally I got the big, big break. And you know what was so interesting about it was the director said at the press conference, if he would have had Schwarzenegger with those muscles, we would have had to build one. And then when I did Terminator, James Cameron said that I'll Be Back and became one of the most famous movie lines in history because of Arnold's crazy accent, because he sounded like a machine. So if you see, everything that the naysayers said was a liability became an asset. Ignore the naysayers. My fourth rule is, work your ass off. You never want to fail because you didn't work hard enough. It doesn't matter what area you're in. No pain, no gain. Listen, when I came to the United States, I remember that I trained 5 hours a day, every day, and I was managing a construction business. I was a bricklayer. And I went to college also. And I took acting classes from 8 o'clock at night to 12 o'clock midnight. Every day I did that. Work your butt off. That's what I always believe. No matter what you do, work, work, work. My fifth and last rule is, don't just take. Give something back. Tear down that mirror that makes you always look at yourself. And you will be able to look beyond that mirror. And you will see the millions and millions of people that need your help. And this is why I tried to take every opportunity that I could to give something back. I started training Special Olympians. I started after-school programs for the most vulnerable children, for inner-city children, to make them be able to say no to drugs, no to gangs, and no to violence. We all can create change, whether it is in our neighborhood or in our local schools, because the bottom line is, it is up to us. Have a vision. Think big. Ignore the naysayers. Work your ass off. And give back and change the world. Because if not us, who? if not now, when?
So yeah, if you don't believe me, believe Schwarzenegger, right? You need to have your goals. I have my goals. I didn't know what I wanted to do in 15 years' time when I started in 2003. I don't know what will happen in the next 15 years. I know I'd like to travel. I know I'd like to talk to people. I know I'd like to help people. Even today, when people ask me, what do you do in WordPress community? Because you're not a WordPress developer or a WordPress designer, because 20% of my work is from WordPress and 80% of my work is from other sources. I say that I really like this community. And when we are talking about being a designer or being a developer or whatever you do, you need to be emotional about it. And people will say that showing emotions is a bad thing. I call that bullshit. I think that being emotional actually helps you see a bigger picture. You can talk with people, you can feel what other people think, you can understand better the problems, and you can bring the better solution. And be passionate, as if you don't have passion, you're definitely doing the wrong job. I repeated that a couple of times. If you don't see yourself being a better designer, a better developer, a better person in 5 years, then what the hell? What are you doing here? And be honest, not only to yourself, but to your clients and your users. It's important. Honesty is the most important thing. Above emotional intelligence, about passion. If you're not honest, if you cannot look someone in the eyes and honestly tell what you think, then you have a problem. And whatever you do, we need to be explorers. Design, not only about design, and not only design, it's not just taking and making some pictures in Photoshop, making some designs, it's much more. It's building an experience because of what we do, not the designers only, but developers as well. We are building products that other people use. We need to make those products, those websites, anything we do, a piece of art. If we are not building a piece of art every single time we do that, again, we have a problem. Don't be afraid of you and unknown. And one of the most important things, always be learning. The good first step is you are here. You got here, and I hope you will have questions after this is all over if we have time. But if not, you can ask me after the talk. Always learn. It's so much easier to learn today than it was 15 or 20 years ago. Just imagine your parents or your grandparents, the possibilities that they did not have, and now you have it. You have internet connection, you have Google, everything is really close. And whatever you do, you always need to do the right thing. I know, doing the right thing is sometimes hard, it takes effort, it takes guts, but doing the right thing is that thing that helps me get up every morning.